Hi, in this video I want to talk about the effects that AI has on productivity. And I think it's going to be interesting for people who already work with AI, like me, because maybe some of the thoughts I have will resonate or you have some feedback to share. But also it will be interesting for people who don't work with AI but want to know how it's going to affect the world, the economy, and our minds, our consciousness, and the world in general. And I have outlined six different effects that AI has had on my work because I built several projects with it, both mature projects, like for example, Nodus AI text analysis tool that I developed, but also some new projects like an iPhone app for heart rate variability tracking that I just made using Swift that I don't know at all. I just coded it with AI. So I have experience both building mature projects and new projects. And during this experience, I observed some of the sensations I had, some thoughts I had. I wrote them down. It's basically 6 points. They have positive aspects, negative aspects, and I just wanted to share it with you to see if you had a similar experience or maybe you had a different experience and just to open up a conversation in this direction. So the first thing that I noticed is that it becomes very easy to build new stuff. I think everyone experienced that, right? Like, especially for the projects that you wanted to build for a long time, but you thought that they were too complicated, or maybe they were not worth it, or maybe the problem was too little for you to kind of give attention to it. Now, suddenly you can build all these forgotten projects or all these old dreams you had, or maybe some small problems that you're experiencing in everyday work and you wanted to automate it. Now, suddenly all of these little projects, ideas that you have in the back of the head become possible. And I think that's a great thing because if we look into the current cycle that we're going through, especially in Europe and in the States, you know, the economy is kind of stagnating. And usually in the ecological development scheme that we also have, by the way, on the Infranodus side, this idea of panarchy, of ecological development going through different stages. So when we go into this period of growth, there's always a period where we need to reorganize things, to find new connections, to create some new spaces for new things to emerge. And I think it's exactly that period that smaller things become more important and suddenly we pay more attention to gaps, to the different areas where we can optimize things, where we can make them work more efficiently, where we point our attention to nuances, where we hone very small parts and niche aspects of certain applications and so on. So it's a great thing because there will be a lot of this stuff developed. And I think for productivity in general, especially if you're at the point of stagnation, is really good because then you can finally find some really interesting new points of growth in there. So that's a positive aspect, I think. And also there is a negative side to it as well, because suddenly when you have a lot of those fragmented services coming up, each solving a specific problem or an issue, right? Like, they will be all disconnected. There will not be maybe one app that combines them all. So they will have some problems in interoperability. Also, some bugs will emerge. Support will be maybe harder to provide because it will just be some software that someone created because they were solving their own problem. And then they disappeared because they switched their attention to something else. So it's kind of both, like, it has this positive aspect that suddenly it's easier to build and there will be a lot of things popping up, but also probably a lot of them will be also left abandoned, and that's maybe a negative aspect of that. So that's the first effect that I noticed. The second one that I think is kind of connected to first, that there is in general like a lot of confidence boost, especially if you didn't know some stuff, right? So for example, if I want to program a new app in a language that I don't know, like Swift, for example, for iOS and for Apple Watch, right? Like, I would have to normally learn this language at first and spend like many hours trying to understand the syntax, how it works, all the frameworks inside and so on. And now I can just go to AI, especially into Cloud Code, for instance, and just tell it to code it from scratch, from zero. You know, I just need to open it in a new Xcode projects and then say what I want, and it's just going to churn out an app for me. And in 10 hours, that's my real experience. In 10 hours, you can have an app up and running. So that, I think, is really amazing that you suddenly have this confidence that you can do things that you couldn't have done before. And even if you thought that you didn't have enough expertise in something, or you didn't know certain framework, or you thought like, oh, I will never be able to do it, now you can suddenly do it. And that, I think, is really great. But again, it comes with a counterbalance, right? Like, because now suddenly a lot of people will feel very confident that they can do stuff, but they will not have enough expertise. So most likely a lot of these things will break. So again, we will have like a productivity boost at the beginning, but then there will probably be some decline or correction that we will need to readjust and kind of like approach it in a more mindful way, maybe learn more things. All of these individual developers, indie hackers, and people who just work on their own, they will have to maybe go back and learn some basics and come back and kind of like refactor their apps, and that will slow down the growth curve. So that will be both the positive aspects that a lot of people can do stuff, but also the negative aspect that a lot of stuff that will come out will be maybe not so high quality. But in general, I think it's a good thing because a lot of people fail not because they tried and it didn't work, but because they couldn't start something. So I think that's a very good aspect that a lot of people will be able to start new things. And especially you can also see it when people, for example, chat with ChatGPT and they ask different questions about fields, let's say if they're interested in solving legal problems or if they want to kind of like try a new path of work, now ChatGPT will always give them positive feedback. So a lot of people who didn't feel like they have enough in them to start something now can suddenly do it. And that I think is a very good thing because it's going to give a lot of people who are not sure in whether or not they can do something a huge confidence boost. But again, there's going to be a lot of very confident people existing in their ChatGPT bubbles. And the extreme case of that is, for example, this guy that thought for a moment that he developed some new scientific discovery. I think you read about him. He was quite known a few months ago. And yeah, basically ChatGPT made him believe that he's some kind of god scientist for a day. And then he realized that he was existing in his own filter bubble. So this is like the other negative aspect of that, right? That we will be creating those filter bubbles, but with ourselves, these deeply solipsistic experiences with AI that will always reassure us that we can do it, that we're the best, that we're thinking in the right direction, but maybe we're completely wrong. So I think there will also be a huge demand for tools and ways of thinking that will be also self-critical at the same time, right? And that will also criticize what AI is producing and try to look at it from another perspective and also find some gaps and also crevices in those ways of thinking so that people don't get lost in their small confidence bubbles they're building. Then another thing I noticed as you develop software using AI or when you work on the projects that involve AI is that you are producing a lot fast. Okay, there's like this first exponential growth, but then when you start going into nuances, you slow down because it becomes very hard as the complexity grows. AI is still not dealing well with big context, with complex stuff, with nuances. So while there is this first exponential growth, then we reach a point where it becomes really hard to continue, where there's some kind of saturation of growth and there is a huge slowdown. So again, I think we'll experience a lot of growth at the beginning, but then there will be a lot of decline and some correction and kind of like people trying to readjust and see how they can refactor those projects and go on with them. Maybe they will realize they need someone with more expertise. Maybe they will realize they need to learn something, or maybe, you know, switch to something else where they have more expertise. So we'll see how that evolves. But I think, again, a huge productivity boost at the beginning. A lot of stuff will come out. They will all compete for attention. So it's also going to be much harder to do marketing, and marketing will decide a lot. But then at the same time, there will be a period of decline when people realize that those things don't work so well, or that to make them really good, you have to work the rest of the 80%, you know, like this 80-20 rule that with the 20% of effort, you can reach 80% of results. Well, in fact, the rest, the remaining 20% is very important, and you probably need to spend 80% of effort on that, but that's what's gonna also make you stand apart from the competition and the rest. So it's kind of like a double-edged sword, right? That you can develop fast, but then to make it really good, to make it really stand out, it's going to take a lot of time, and maybe it will even be more complicated because AI will develop something that you don't understand and you cannot really get into the nuances or fix the little things that need to be fixed to make it really work. This also brings me to another problem that I observed is that a lot of this code or a lot of these projects that come out from AI, they're full of bugs and mistakes, especially if you're dealing with maths. So for example, one app that I'm working on at the moment that I developed is an app for iPhone that measures heart rate variability, but fractality of it, right? Like it's additional metric that is not so well known, but it's very useful for estimating whether you're in adaptive state, whether you're entering into anaerobic threshold. So it's very good if you want to kind of like understand whether your system is being adaptive enough, resilient, and when you need to switch to rest, for example, or when you need to do more effort. And it involves some complex maths that, for example, AI itself would not be able to program. It would make me believe that it can program it, but actually when it comes to it, it doesn't do a good job. Like it makes mistakes, but it tells you that it solved the problem. And then when you look at the code, when you look at the math, it's actually not correct. So I think there will be a lot of bugs coming up like that, where you will think that the project is actually doing the job, but it's not doing the job well. And actually people will not understand that it's not doing the job well. So that's going to be really bad, especially if you're dealing with numbers. So we will probably have some catastrophes occurring along the way when people will implement some products, AI agents, apps, even decisions. Maybe we all heard about how doctors are using AI more and more, but they're actually providing advice that is not so good, right? Because they maybe think, I don't know, the GPT-4 is better than GPT-3, or like we had this a few months ago, right? When they had this model naming convention, when doctors were actually using worse models than the models that they can use. So yeah, I think that people will kind of need to really understand how to use the AI to get the best possible results in all fields, and especially in the fields that deal with really precise calculations or with really precise knowledge that you kind of need to be really sure about, and where you need to avoid hallucinations. We'll have a lot of bugs coming up and a lot of problems emerging. So again, it's going to look like there is a productivity boost, but then there will be a huge correction. And I think it might even put some people out of business. So I would not even say it's like a productivity boost, but rather perhaps some kind of redistribution of wealth that's going to happen there. That some companies that will implement it will go exponential, and some companies will just have really catastrophic failures that will make them lose their clients a lot of money and so on. But this money will maybe shift to somebody else, maybe to those small indie developers who will become temporarily rich on their projects, right? And these big companies that manage to nail it really well. So that's quite an interesting outcome that we have to wait and that we have to be also wary of. And I think when we also see some tools, applications, and approaches that emerge that solve this problem, this is going to be very good stuff to work on. And they will also bring a lot of value, because like the things that will actually correct the AI output, that will be able to notice whether it hallucinates or not, whether it implemented the correct algorithm, whether it's really providing a good answer for a particular field. Those things are going to be very, very useful and very, very important. Another thing that I observed that I find very interesting is that AI allows you to get into the field that you maybe don't know so much about. And I think that will be really great for interdisciplinary work because, for example, myself, I know about mathematics and I know about economics and I know about software development, and I'm also working with the body, with different body practices and so on. But there are some things I don't know so well. So for example, now with AI, I can get into a certain field with the knowledge I already have. So for example, I know about network science and I want to see something about physiology, for instance, right? Medicine. So I can use some of the information that I can get from AI to understand what I need to learn in this field to make it easier for me to kind of digest it, to get into it, to split it into parts that will enable me to learn it well. And I think that's really great because suddenly a person from one field can enter into another and see if the insights from their field can be applied in that other field or vice versa, which is maybe more likely, right? Like you just get into a new field and you see that, okay, in that other field, they're using some approach that maybe will be useful in your field. So suddenly you have access to all this knowledge. And I think this is super, super interesting. And that will create a lot of really interesting inventions and also products and art pieces. And I think this is going to be very exciting. Of course, again, the negative aspect of that is that a lot of those connections will probably not make sense and people will claim that they came up with some new invention, but when they put it to test into real life, it will turn out it doesn't work so well. So we'll have a lot of big claims that will result in nothing. But as long as we're wary of the possibility, I think then we're good to go. Another thing that I also want to mention is that the work becomes much more high level than before, right? So if before I had to focus on how to debug a certain thing or write a certain algorithm, or for example, focus on writing a marketing copy or thinking whether the grammar is correct, now I can delegate all this small stuff to AI and focus on the architecture of what I'm building. So if it's a code, for instance, if I'm developing software, I can focus on high-level architecture of the whole thing. If I'm a writer or a researcher, I can focus on high-level thinking, how I can bring different disciplines together, how I can combine them, and so on. So this is very interesting that you're thinking in general on a higher level, and that allows you to bring in a lot more connections and kind of like operate on the level of an architect, of an orchestrator of the whole thing. Again, a negative aspect is that if you forget how to do this small but important stuff, gradually, you know, we will all become dumber. But then at the same time, we already had this concern when the calculators came in or computers, and actually didn't happen. It looks like everything went fine. There are people who can do all this low level stuff, and it's very important. And sometimes it's even more important to approach them from first principles and to kind of reinvent how the whole thing works, of course. But in general, I think this higher level operation will bring a lot of interesting results, insights, and give us a productivity boost. So I'm quite optimistic about this as well. So I think this is kind of like an overview of the main ideas I had about like this whole thing of working with AI and building with AI. I think one thing on a more emotional level, what I noticed is that it's very addictive. And I also saw it from a lot of people who work with it, that it kind of like really gets you in because you can build so fast. The exponent is so fast at the beginning. It's so exciting. So that's really interesting aspect of it. I hope that people don't go into AI fully immersed into it with their brains and bodies and forget about everything else, but that's like a huge danger. But also at the same time, perhaps it makes them more involved into their work and also more productive. So let's see how that evolves. But that's also an interesting aspect, and I heard from a lot of people that they had a similar experience as well. I wonder what you think about this whole thing, what effect it had on your work, positive or negative. If you want to share something, please leave a comment below this video. I would be really interested to discuss it with you. And yeah, I hope you find it useful and interesting. In general, I have quite a positive outlook. But for example, if you were to invest into AI, I would suggest that yes, there will be growth and probably it will be exponential, but there will definitely be correction when we will have to pay all the technical debt, when we will have to deal with all the bugs, with all the hallucinations, with all the problems, with all the things that are breaking, with the people who will not be able to support their one-man projects because suddenly they lost interest or they switched their attention to something else. So we'll have a lot of problems coming in, and there will be a huge correction, maybe a little bit like a bust, kind of like a dot-com bust, right? But then I think in general it will come up again and stay on a very good level. And maybe we will not evolve further if we keep on pushing for exponential growth, but maybe this AI thing will actually enable us to look for the nuances, to look into the little details, to find those overlooked projects, those problems that no one wants to solve because they seemed too boring or uninteresting, or maybe they would take too much time and now suddenly they can be done much faster. So I think that will be pretty interesting as well, how it's going to help us move into a new way of working that perhaps will have some really positive outcomes. And in my own experience, for instance, you know, I noticed that I can code sometimes 5 times faster, and when I'm working on some mundane stuff, you know, I can maybe work 2x faster. So there's definitely this productivity increase, and there's definitely the ability to enter into the fields that I would be a little bit afraid to enter into, like maybe some legal stuff or tech stuff, and to kind of like try to think myself how I can resolve this problem without necessarily consulting to experts. So that's also quite interesting, because AI, it kind of replaces the expert for you. Of course, it doesn't mean that you shouldn't consult an expert, but now you can suddenly come to the expert with a much more defined problem. And I think that's another really good outcome of that, that you can now be have a feeling of being an expert in the field, and then consult a real expert with the idea that is much more defined, much more precise, and where you know much more what you're talking about. So the quality of the service that you will be provided will also be much higher. And I think that's also in general a really good outcome. So let's leave it at that, and I hope to hear back from you, and thank you for your attention. Until next time.